Today, we have an incredible flood of ungodliness that is coming against us. Where the world is saying one thing is true and God says something else is true, and we are finding that there is an opposition and you cannot reconcile the truth and a lie. I'm not trying to be melodramatic today. In fact, just the opposite. I am trying to shake you from indifference. The truth of God is so vital. It is so vital that it is understood, taught, and preached, because lies are being presented as the truth. Today is a very controversial message. If you want something to argue about, something to be upset about, maybe today's the message you ought to listen to. Because today, we're going to go right to the book of Romans, and we're going to deal with the lies that are being told by the world and presented as truth, and yet God says that we must be the standard bearers. As I spoke last week, and I speak today, today is going to be a little frank. Next week might even be a little more frank. We're going to be very specific about what we mean when we say it's time to raise up a standard of God's love, but also of God's truth. If I don't tell you the truth, I cannot say I love you. The world and sometimes the church has said, well, if we just show the love of God, we can just let them believe whatever they want. But the truth is, lies and deception bring death and pain. Truth must be shared in love. And today, I believe you'll get a balance of what it is to speak the truth, yet always operate in the love of God. I hope you enjoy today's message, Standard Bearers, Part 2. Psalm 60, verse 4 says this, "You have given a banner to those who fear you, that it may be displayed because of truth." How many of you fear God? It's, you know what? It is a very unpopular saying, but it's a biblical quote. How many of you fear God? There you go, young man, right? You know what? It's okay to fear God. You know what? I feared my father. I know that's not popular today. People, I feared him for a couple reasons. One, I didn't want to disappoint him because I love my father, and disappointing him would break my heart. Second reason I feared him is because his spankings hurt really bad. As a grown man, they would hurt really bad. Did my father abuse me? Oh, probably, yeah, quite possibly. By today's standards, it don't take much. You know, shame on you, I'm abused! You know, I mean. I can tell you stories. I won't. Here's the deal. I don't believe in abuse in any form or fashion whatsoever. I want that to be clear. I do believe in the fear of the Lord. I believe in the fear of your parent. And it is important and, in fact, vital that your children have an awe and respect for you and what you say and do. And part of that comes by being a man of God. My father may have had a little heavy hand and he may have not done everything right, but one thing I knew is my dad loved Jesus and my dad loved me, and he was a man after God's own heart. Yes. And so I had respect for my father, still do. And I want to encourage you that today we are having a loss of the fear of God. God says, listen, I can give a banner. I can display truth in those people who fear me. But if they don't fear me, if there's no respect for me, if there's no respect for what I stand for, if there's no respect for truth, I can't give you a banner. I give a banner to those who fear me. Fear of the Lord is not something that's popular, but it's something that's a necessity if the church is going to remain in truth. Because you cannot represent God adequately, you can't do it effectively without your own personal fear of the Lord. It's time that we not only get into this lovey, you know, good gospel, God's my bro. Ooh, God, my buddy, my God's my bro, we're hanging out. That's a great idea, but you know what? It doesn't fly in Scripture. God's not your buddy. He's not your friend in a sense that you're just going to hang out and he's going to accept anything you do and he's just going to encourage you in it. That's not true. God is your friend because he can speak the truth to you. God is your friend because he's someone who will be real. See, we like friends that tell us what we want to hear, but a real friend will tell you the truth.
Yeah.
God's that kind of friend. He's also a father. He brings discipline and justice. Not always easy. I'm still on the review. Isaiah 5:26 says this, I will lift up a banner to the nations from afar. He lifts up a banner and from the nations from afar. Can I just tell you that as you raise the banner of truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and if I get excited today and yell, I'm asking already you forgive me because I'm a little passionate about all this. But as you raise up a banner of truth, nations from afar will be affected. This morning, before I even got out of bed, I was already praying and in contact with people from Africa, the Philippines, and from Pakistan this morning before I ever set my feet out of bed. They see the banner of truth, and we begin to see that God is beginning to spread all over the nations. 60 pastors are preparing even now for some teaching that we're doing in Africa, in Nigeria, and in Ghana. It's crazy what God is doing. But as I tell you this, folks, it isn't because we have a soft gospel that has Jesus as just, I love everybody. Of course he loves everybody. But he doesn't stand for lies and a manipulation of the truth. The truth is still the truth. He says, listen, I raise up a banner and the nations from afar will come and I will whistle to them from the ends of the earth and they will come running swiftly. They're going to come running when they hear the whistle, the bugle, the trumpet of God. They come running. Folks, I want to tell you that we have believed as a Christian society that the only way to men's hearts is to compromise the truth. And I want to tell you that is not true. You're feeling overwhelmed by the flood, as Isaiah 59 says. You're feeling overwhelmed by this flood. But Jesus doesn't say the flood of lies, the flood of humanism, the flood of that is literally invading our society. We don't just succumb to it. We raise up a standard, a banner. What is a standard? A revelation of who Jesus is. You're not only called to hold the standard, you're called to be the standard. I could preach on this a long time, but there's no way I can do it today. So I just want to state this. I want to give you another example other than standard. The lamp of clay. We are the lamp, right? We're the clay pot, easily broken, right? Just simply a clay pot. Inside of it is oil, the Holy Spirit, right? And the light represents what? There we go. A good Bible student in the back. Us. Yeah, the other church sometimes says things they're not so used to the fact that you probably best not to answer when I ask a question because it's going to be wrong. I'm baiting you. Truth is, the light is not, quote unquote, just Jesus. It is Jesus. But we're the lamp, the oil, and the light. Jesus said, we're the light of the world. The light represents us. But why wouldn't it represent Jesus? It does. The glory of God, the shining forth of God, those are the things that are God, but he uses us as the reflection of who he is. So we're not only holding the standard today, folks, I want to submit to you, we are the standard. We are to this world what Jesus does. And our failures matter. And our repentance should be public. To what degree? To whatever degree your sin was public, so your repentance should be public also. To whatever degree your sin has hurt other people, that degree is where your repentance should be public. But be careful just noising it abroad that somehow it becomes, instead of a testimony, it becomes a way you gain acceptance. Do you hear me? Some of the more mature, I think, understand that. Still reviewing from last week, I have to give this illustration that I gave of Maverick, because it kind of sets the tone of understanding the difference between arguing and discussing. See, we're not called to argue. We're not here to argue Christianity. We're not here to argue it at all. In fact, real communication only happens with a bed of love. Literally, that you've set out a bed, a seed bed of love, ground that is tilled and ready. And then when seed falls on that, because you've had love in your heart, and I'll explain this in a minute, seed then can grow. I'm about to deal with some pretty heavy issues, and so I've got to set this. We're not here to argue, we're here to discuss. My four-year-old walks up to me. I wanted to get kind of face-to-face with him. I'm in the bedroom, so I just lay down on the side of the bed. We're face-to-face. I want you to see this picture. And he's got some little candies in his hand, and he says, "Daddy, what's the difference between discussion and argument?" I said, "Why? You're four. Why are you asking me this? What four-year-old asked me a question like that, you know? Could you explain to me the dispensations of truth throughout the scripture?" You know, what? Might as well have, you know? I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, my teacher said that we could have discussions, but we couldn't argue. And I don't know what she meant." Oh, that's fair enough. So I grab his candy out of his hand, which I got this look, you know, I said, "I'll give it back." And so I pulled the candy out of his hand. I set two pieces of candy, a pink one and a blue one, down. And I said simply this. I said, "You see, son, a discussion is when I look at you and I say, I like this pink candy. And you look at me and you say, I like this blue candy." And truth be told, he said, "But Daddy, I like the pink candy better." I'm like, "Okay, fine. Okay." So... But to stick with the story, I said, "Okay, so I said, the pink candy, if I like the pink candy, you like the blue candy." I said, "A discussion is when I tell you that I like the pink candy and I tell you why. And I do my best to invoke my passion for pink candy. I just really tell you that I love pink candy. And I said, and you tell me why you like blue candy. And you explain to me why you like that candy." Now that's a discussion. But an argument is when I try to make you like my pink candy and I'm not happy. I might even not be your friend unless you like pink candy. And you are upset at me and you want me to like. I have to like my blue candy. You have to like my blue candy. And sometimes we share the gospel that way. I know that this is the difference between life and death, eternal damnation, or eternity with God. I understand it's a big deal, but you're not going to get anywhere arguing with people. I present truth. My job is to present truth. I'm a presenter of truth. Your job is a presenter or proclaimer of truth. That's what you share. And you must do it in love, or it brings no fruit. None. You bring truth in hatred, it will never be good. It will never bring forth good fruit. Ever. You bring it in love, it may. You cannot change someone because of your testimony, because of your proclamation, but what you have to do is be willing to tell it. Because if you don't tell it, then they will not hear, is what the scripture says. If you don't tell it, they won't hear. How will they hear without a preacher? And how will they be sent unless someone sends them? Romans 1, if you turn there. I spoke a little on this last week. It's going to be a little more blunt today. I hope you understand I'm not carrying a torch of anti-homosexual issues. That's not my heart. That's not my desire. That's not what I'm doing. Romans 1, if you go to some, not all, some provinces, I shared this last week. If you go to those provinces in Canada, some of them have began to have fines attached to preachers who will simply read Romans 1 from their pulpit. It's already in place. They're already being fined if they simply read it. This isn't Pakistan or Iran, or this is Canada. In the books, if you did the law, most of this has not yet happened. They haven't imprisoned anyone yet, but it actually carries up to a 1 year time in prison or jail. Some have been threatened with up to 3 months. Now, understand that that's in Canada for reading what they would consider hate speech. Okay? I encourage you, go online, look at it, see. It's not all throughout Canada, just certain provinces. The inroad is being made. Lies are becoming truth. And truth is becoming a lie. Now, I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I often planned to come to you, but was hindered until now, that I might have some fruit among you. This is really important that you understand this before we get into the next portion of Scripture. The Apostle Paul says, listen, it's so important that I have fruit among you, meaning this, that I have fruit of the Spirit, and it's really, I believe, there he was referring to it being portrayed in people's lives, and that he has people and fruit, and that he has showed the love of God to those people. I believe that's what he's talking about. But either way, he's saying, listen, until I have fruit among you, I can't speak to you. Folks, we need to learn that. We really need to learn that. You cannot speak into somebody's life until you have first invested and loved them. Hate will never bring forth good fruit. It is not a fruit of the Spirit. But lying will not bring forth good fruit either. I mean, you lie to somebody, they're deceived. How can good fruit come out of deception? Well, I love them. Can I just tell you that truth and love go together? They're not supposed to be separate. Just like truth and law. Truth is truth. Let's not add to it and call it legalism. We do too often that as Christians. We take the truth, we add to it, it becomes legalism. Let's just stick with what the truth is. But we need to stick with what the truth is. And we have to have somebody who's willing to proclaim it, and somebody like the Apostle Paul who is willing to say, I'm about to tell you some really tough things, and I couldn't tell them to you until I first had some good fruit among you. Until you first could see my heart and my intentions, I have to first put down a bed of love, and then I throw the seeds of truth, and then it'll be between you and God whether they grow or not. Verse 16, chapter 1, Romans 1, 16. He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, praise the Lord. It's about time somebody isn't. For it is the power of God to salvation. It's like having a muscle car and putting a little, you know, GO3 banger in it, you know? That's what we've done to the gospel. We've necked it down to mean nothing. Oh yeah, I mean, it's like plumbing. If you take a pipe, you can take a pipe this big and you can put a whole bunch of pressure behind it. But if you neck it down to this big, you only got that much water coming out. Folks, we have necked down the gospel to nothing and wonder where the power is. I don't know. You've been sharing the gospel as if it's a lie. There's a truth to the gospel. There's a truth to God's word. Why are we as the people of God ashamed of it? We're the standard bearers. We're the ones that hold up the truth. We're the ones that flap in the wind. That when the Holy Spirit breathes on us, the fire of God, the truth of God, the love of God begins to go out into the nations. Amen. Field of dreams. Feeding. Hands of hope feeding. The breakfast in the morning, why are we doing all these things? Because we're seeding love first. We're giving something first. We run the vans and the buses because we're giving it away first. If you go to our website, all our ministry is given away because why? We're not selling the gospel. Right now by television, throughout this whole city, right now, this message, right this moment is available. Why? Because we just want to get the love of Jesus out. Yeah. But the love of Jesus can't be compromised with lies, because along with love has to come truth. If my father loved me, he would have never disciplined me, right? No, the Bible says if a father loves his child, he will discipline him. If not, he hates him. See, I can tell you a nice message that will draw you in, and we can all sing Kumbaya, sit around the campfire. We bought a camp. We have a camp. We have a campfire. Praise God. You know, we can all meditate. But when I deny the truth of God, I present a lie that becomes powerless. When I tell you the truth, but I refuse to show my fruit and love, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, long-suffering, and all the rest, because I forget them whenever I try to say them. I have to have my four-year-old around to tell me what they are. Folks, if I tell the truth without the fruit, without having fruit, I hurt people. But if I have fruit and love without telling the truth, I hurt people also. In fact, I destroy them. They have no hope. For it is the power of God to salvation for everyone, first to the Jew and then to the Greek. Verse 17, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. You have been justified, you should now live by faith, by trusting, believing, putting your full assurance in God. Verse 18, for the wrath of God, now no one likes to hear about the wrath, right? The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Can I just say to you, two things are going to be shared here. One is that all men have an understanding of the gospel. All men understand there's a God. We'll read this in just a moment. But the suppression of the truth does not come from the world. Oh, there's a flood of lies. But you know where the suppression of the truth really leaks into the church? It is the unrighteousness of us. When we walk out of the righteousness of God and begin to live in unrighteousness. Today, almost every podcast, not everyone, majority of podcasts that are out there that you have an opportunity to listen to and be blessed by, all these TV preachers, and there's some good ones, but I want to tell you, most of them, the messages are more about how to not have to repent. They're more about how to not have to live for God. They're more about how God understands and loves you no matter what you're doing. That's all true. But it's presented in a way that says there is no standard, there is no truth. Well, I'm sure they have a love for God. Folks, come on. So what God says here is, listen, it is the ones that are serving God that have began to suppress the truth. It's you and me. When we don't live the gospel or be quick to repent. Thank the Lord that God said, listen, when you fail, when you don't live up to the standard, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, that you can run to. Thank the Lord for that. But where's the truth being held up? Listen to what he goes on to say here. For the wrath of God, verse 18, is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. How do they do it? By living unrighteous. Because what may be known of God is manifested in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. They're without excuse, folks. You can't say, well, they didn't know. Well, then you need to tell them. He says, because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into the image like corruptible men, birds, four-footed animals, and creepy things. My mom used to just say creepers. Verse 24, therefore, because of all that, and this chapter 20, or verse 24 and 25, can I just tell you, is the crux of Romans. Not the next verses. This is the crux. If you want to get the crux of it all, this is what Paul was saying. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves. Why? Because they've exchanged the truth of God for lies and worship and serve the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Folks, we have a flood. Isaiah 59:19 says that there is a flood coming. A flood coming that speaks and literally overtakes. Have you ever had a flood? You've seen floods on television. It's a scary thing. Tsunamis are scary things. Flooding is a scary thing. It literally just overruns you. Isaiah 59:19 says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, if you know what I am today? I'm literally like Paul Revere. I'm literally coming out and I'm yelling, I'm screaming, the flood is here, the flood is here. Your houses are being washed away. Your children are being whisked away. They're here. It's here. It's not, be an easy message, but I'm telling you, it's a needed message for today. We must be a standard bearer, because he says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. Oh, praise Jesus. Let's just pray. You better pray. You better pray. You better be a man of and a woman of intercession. In Isaiah 59, 1 or 2, or no, excuse me, it's in there. 59 somewhere. God looks out and says, where are the intercessors? Where is the man of God? Where have they all went? They're nowhere. And God says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, I will raise up a standard against them. Can I tell you, the standard that God is raising up today is you and me, a standard of truth, a standard of the gospel. And the church is literally split into two ways. It seems like there's those that are angry and hateful and mean, and then there are those that are literally lawless, and they've just given in to, oh, the love of God, the love of God, the love of God. But you've got to seed it with truth. Right. You got to just have the love without the truth. So where is the truth? Well, Paul's going to just go ahead and lay it right out. Verse 26, for this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. For even their women. Now, understand something. What I'm about to read, please hear me. He's going to give an example of a whole lot of things. But he wants to set an example of something that's so obvious and evident in their society that they'll understand the other things he's about to say. So he is not only talking about homosexuality here. He is laying it out as one example of many. You understand? So please don't run away from here going, well, it's all about homosexuality. No, if we've got to raise up a standard of what's right and what's wrong, what's truth, what the Bible says, not what you say. Quit adding to it, but just do what it says, say what it says, don't add to it, and don't take away from it. And do it in love. And do it knowing that God's restoring and forgiving and loving, but speak the truth. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, and even their women exchanged the natural use for what was against nature.
By the way, I know that there's a lot of people want to say, well, you just don't understand what it really meant here. And you, well, it's all translation. And let me just tell you what it didn't mean. It did, we weren't talking about doing dishes. We weren't talking about cleaning house. For even their women exchanged the natural use for what was against nature. Paul was trying to be a little diplomatic, but it was pretty obvious what he was saying. Women were literally becoming lesbians. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of a woman, burned with their lust for another man. Men with men committing what is shameful. You can't say very many things that are funny at this point because people take them wrong. And receiving in themselves the penalty of the error which was due. What do you think they're talking about there? Well, I don't think that really applies for today. Well, I don't think... And even as they do not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind. Now who? 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 Homosexuals? No. Yes, them, but not just them. All those who exchange the truth for a lie. Everybody who exchanges the truth for a lie and lives in a lie. Not just homosexuals, all of them. You say, but I think they were born that way. You want to know what? Ding, ding, ding. So do I. Three messages. I had to finally bring it up here. I think they are too. All of them? Oh, heck no. Some? Very few. But some are. I think some are born that way. So? Let me tell you a little secret about me. I was born in sin. And I needed a savior. Sin is what God reveals his nature, and we become like him, not like us. We're not trying to become like four-footed animals, like birds. We're not trying to be like our like other men. We're not comparing ourselves to other men or what they do. We compare ourselves to God, and we want to be more like God. Now, I was born with a nature. Some women won't understand this, but I actually was born with a very lustful nature. And as I grew up as a young man, I thought the coolest thing in the world was to have sex with as many women as possible. And I lusted after everything that simply walked by. That's wrong. It's destructive to family and friends and everyone else. Our world would say, well, that's just, it's an issue as long as you contain it right. No, it's wrong. It's sin. It's ugly. It's wrong. It's a fallen, sinful nature. And God had to deliver me. And I had to begin to choose God's way instead of my own. I was born lustful and sinful. According to what God says is right and wrong. Somebody born in homosexuality and they have a lustful desire for someone of the same sex, it's still a matter of right and wrong. We have to love them. We have to love them, but we have to speak the truth if we love them. It is so, so important that you realize that while I was born in sin and you were born in sin, we choose God. Is it an easy choice? No. Am I compassionate when I know it's hard for people? Yes. I understand it's hard. But right is still right, wrong is still wrong, and someone has to stand up for what's right. And who will do that? Who will do that? Our civilization, our culture is literally resting on a precipice right now. Listen to what God goes on and says. He says, and even as they do not retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are fitting. being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality. Now here's the list, guys. He's not just talking about homosexuality. It's all these people who exchange the truth of God for a lie. The things that used to be a lie are now considered true, and the things that used to be true are now considered a lie. And our education system says, just, you know what, we're going to tell you the truth. Don't fight with your parents over it, but someday they'll die off and we'll have a society that will be accepting. No, that is called manipulation. That is called, they're literally brainwashing our children to believe the things that are true, that we call true, are lies, and the things that we call lies are truth. It's right here. Being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, that's way more than homosexuality. You're having sex outside of marriage, that's sexual immorality, and you deserve death. Does that mean I'm going to personally kill you? No, that means I'm going to share the love of God, the purpose of God, I'm going to share the truth of God, but it's between you and God. And I wouldn't want to die in that condition. I don't want to die in that condition. How's that? Wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent. He's not saying all these things. Do you fit into these? Proud, how? Boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. That's not happening in our day. Undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who know the righteous judgments of God, that those who practice such things are, not all things, just those kinds of things, are deserving of death. By the way, the death there is an eternal death. Now, you want to see something that's even more difficult to swallow? Now, see, but God loves everybody, you know? But you know what? It's not just the people doing it. Listen to what it goes on to say. Not only the ones that do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. Well, I just think gay marriage is okay. I think that's okay. You voted for that? Just because you want to be kind and considerate and loving. And God says you deserve the same punishment of eternal death that they do. As well as the proud, the gossiper. It's not just homosexuality. It's all of it. We're either led by the Spirit or we're not. We're either going after the things of God or we're not. God is going to speak the truth, and he needs a people who will speak the truth. Because what's happening is truth is being presented incorrectly. And somebody has to begin to stand up and tell the truth. He says, not only those who do it, but those who approve it. I don't know about you, but that makes me swallow hard. When the enemy comes in like a flood, and he's coming in our school systems, he's coming in. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will rise up a standard against him. Folks, we're just going to end on this, 2 Corinthians 5. For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him. Did you hear me? We don't live for ourselves. We live for him, who died for them and rose for them. We are not called to live. And God's not out here saying, I just want you to have the best life. It's all about you having an easy time. I just want you to be happy. Happy has to do with circumstances. Joy, God wants you full of joy, love, peace. And when you speak the truth, you're not pointing at somebody and saying, you're going to hell, you're evil, you're horrible. You speak the truth in love. You tell them about your nice little pink piece of candy and why you love it. You tell them about your Jesus and why you love it. I've never saved one person in my life, but I've watched thousands come to Jesus because of just telling the truth. The truth sits, it'll set men free. Listen to what he says, therefore, verse 16, if we, 2 Corinthians 5:16, therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. All things have become new. Now all things are of God who has reconciled us to himself. He said, listen, when you're born again, all things are of God. Your life becomes about God. He says, who has reconciled himself through Jesus Christ to give us something. He gave us the ability to hold up the standard of truth, to reconcile men to God. He is holding up a standard. It's you. He's saying, listen, I need you to lift up a standard when the enemy comes in the school system and begins to flood us with lies. You tell the truth. So I ask you this. Later on, he says, I implore you. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that's talking about Jesus, that we might become the righteousness of God, the standard of God, that we might become the truth that the world would see. Lakewood, California, you can drive from Compton into Lakewood, California, and as you drive in any direction, come on any street, you see this sign, times change, values don't. I love that stuff, because I wish that's what our world really believed. Times change, values don't. Times change, truth doesn't. People change, but God remains the same. What is truth today is still truth. It'll still be truth in 100 years, 1,000 years. When we're with Christ, it'll still be truth. Culture is about fashion, arts, entertainment, education, movies, music, literature, manners, and scholarly pursuits, spirituality, and religion. Your culture is everything. And all those things shape culture. And the culture is shaping our churches. When our churches have, for so many unbelievable amount of years, have shaped culture. It is time that we stand up and realize that we're called to be people who actually shape culture. The church has been shoved into little boxes called churches. The body of Christ has been shoved in these boxes. We call them churches. And they say, share your stuff there. Be weird there. Just don't come out and tell us about it. I don't know about you, but like God said, I'd whistle and they'd come running. I'll tell you what, I want to just bust it out of here. Television is about busting it out of here. You know, feeding and helping, about putting fruit in the ground, busting it out of here. If you don't tell them, then who will? I want to ask you this, and this is how we're going to end today. I want to ask you, if you don't tell the truth, then who will? Who's going to tell the truth? He works through you. God speaks through you. If you don't tell the truth, then who will? Is there any groups in town that are going to say what's right and wrong about sexuality? Oh yeah, there is. There's a bunch of hateful, angry, mean-spirited people that'll stand up and do more damage than good. That's who we want to tell the truth. Mean-spirited, no fruit. Is there anyone in our community that will stand up and speak the truth? If so, who is it? It is the church. Or it's nobody. Folks, the next time you make out a tithe check, I just want you to realize that you're giving to something. Because together we can do something that alone we cannot do. And yet together, we need to each and individually do something that even together we can't do. We need to be the people who raise the standard. The next time you decide whether you should come to church or not, remember, there's only a select group of people. It is God's people who will stand up and proclaim the truth. In this community, forget everything everywhere else. Let's just take it down to Springfield and Eugene. Crosswell. We'll add Crosswell to it. Okay, Cottage Grove too. Well, boy, man, you guys got a big wish list, don't you? Okay, all Lane County. In Lane County, who is going to tell the truth? Is there anyone else? I would beg you, outside of the body of Christ, is there anyone that's going to tell the truth? So what are we waiting for, and who are we waiting to tell the truth? I hope this opens your eyes today, this simple truth, that there is no one that will tell the truth except the people of God. No one. And if it's not you, then who is it? No one. Then we have literally turned our generations over to the devil for destruction. When you tell the truth, you're loving people. If you don't do it now, then when are you going to start? When it gets worse? Folks, it can't get much worse. Okay, I'm going to skip one more scripture in, but then I'm done. Hebrews 12:1, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and every sin that so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of God, the throne of God. How many of you know that what Jesus did was to show us how to stand for the truth, how to live for the truth, and how to die for the truth?
Yeah.
If the truth isn't told, men believe lies. I can't do this on my own. In fact, I can't do this at all without your help. And yet, no matter how much I do, I can only be effective to the degree that I can be effective. It's when the body of Christ arises and becomes the body of Christ that the truth will be told. We live in one of the darkest areas of our country. Less people believe God, go to church here than anywhere else. That is not a reason to put our head in the sand. It's a reason to proclaim the truth. Where is the light? Jesus said, set the light upon a hilltop, that it would give light to the whole city, the whole valley. Folks, I've given my life to this city. I could have moved many places and made much more money. And I got to tell you, to live in a city where you've had to repent before the people, where it's obvious that you're a man and a man who can fail. I want to tell you something. It's not the easiest place to live. But I want to tell you, the call of God is greater than than me. And what it took was for me to learn humility. And it not be about me, but it be about him. It be about the truth. I want to ask you here today, how many of you are willing to stand for the truth so that the truth can be heard? Not what I say, what this book says. Well, but Pastor, no, just read it. Well, but I don't understand all that. Just read it. If you just read it, quit talking about it and read it. It's God's revelation of who he is for you, so that you can reveal who he is to a generation, to children who need to know it. I'm not going to just die off and let all the rest of the generations believe a lie. When I'm wrong, I'm not going to change the Bible to conform to my failures. I'm wrong. It's right. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to ask these two simple things. Number one, Do you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? Really, it all breaks down to this. Do you know Jesus? See, well, yeah, but I'm living in sin. We're all living in sin when we come to Christ. There's nowhere else to live. You can't fix it or get it better. You just need Jesus. Yeah, but I've been going to church a long time. I don't know that I can admit that I'm a sinner. Join the club. Church is for people who need to find Christ and get better and disciple and learn to live for God and learn the truth. And if you're here today and you do not know Jesus, or if you're backslidden, or if you've refused the truth and today you'd like to know Him as your Savior, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand so we can pray with you. Is there anyone here that would say, Pastor, that's me. I need Jesus. The other campus, we had different ones raise their hand. I see this one. See that one. I see this one. Anyone else? You say, I've been just not living for God, but I want to today. Anyone else? Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Anyone else? Second thing I want to ask is this. If you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Aaron, I've been a Christian for a long time, but I've really not been a light that's shining, but I want to today. I'm going to ask you to simply just raise your hand with me. Is that you? I want to shine. I want to shine. If you raised your hand to accept Christ, I'm going to give you an opportunity in just a second to come and just pray with someone. They can't save you, but they can pray with you. They can stand with you. They can lead you in a prayer that simply just says, God, I believe in you. I trust you. I ask you to forgive me of my sins and set me free. And proclaims that you're born again of the Spirit of God. Can you do that yourself? Yeah. But the Bible says if you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth, meaning that this is a time of confession. It's a time of humility. It's a time of saying, God, you hung on the cross naked and exposed for me. I could simply just let the world know and be your light, your truth. One died for all, but we all now live for Him. We all stand to our feet. If you raised your hand to recommit your heart to the Lord, or maybe for the first time to commit your life to Christ, there was quite a few. Some have already had to step out, but I'm going to ask you to step out from where you're at. Don't be embarrassed. Amen. I see him already starting to step out. Just come up. We'd like to pray with you. Come on. Come on. So let's pray for one another. Heavenly Father, I thank you for those that are here. So many raise their hands saying, I want to be an example of who you are. I want to stand for the truth. If we don't stand for something, we will fall for everything. God, let us stand for truth. Let us find your truth. Lord, I just ask that, Lord, you'd begin to reveal yourself to each and every one. That, Father, that the love of God would precede all that we do, that we would have fruit in people's lives that would remain. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. And Lord, for those that are praying to dedicate their hearts to the Lord, some for the very first time to accept you as their Savior. Lord, I thank you today that, Father, we don't want to believe the lies of the world. We don't want to believe the deception, but Lord, we want the truth of God's Word. Lord, reveal yourself. Open it up and just reveal yourself to them. Lord, we love you.
If not now, then when? When will you share the gospel? When will you stand up for the truth? If not you, then who? Pretty vital that we hear those words. You're going to hear me say them for the next 2 weeks because it's so important that we understand that now is the time. And the truth of God must be shared by His people because there's no one else that will do it. Maybe you're one that's listened today. And I'm not just rallying the church, but maybe you're one that's been lied to. You believe lies. Instead, you say, man, I understand that God's way is the right way, and I would like to enter into His love and His acceptance. And I'm not going to tell you, quit any bad things you're doing. I'm going to tell you, enter into the love of God, and God will give you a desire to change your ways. Today, if you'll simply believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, you can be saved. I want to encourage you to call the number at the bottom of the screen or contact us. You can write us. You can email us if you'd like a little more anonymity. It's okay. We just want to reach out and help you with the love and the truth of God. I want to thank you that have supported this ministry, who believe in the truth and are willing to stand for the truth, because those that have been lied to and are deceived, it's not about an act or what we do or we don't do. It is about that deception stops us from understanding and finding the love of God. Today, you and I, we can find the love of God. I encourage you to do so. I encourage you to continue to support this ministry as we preach the truth, live the truth, and give the love of God every day, sometimes in tangible ways, sometimes by the Word of God, sometimes just by what we stand for. But we show forth the love of God. I want to encourage you to be a part of this ministry. Check it out online at www.mycrossfire.com, or come and be a part of an incredible family of loving believers that accept people just as they are, but refuse to let the enemy continue to lie to them so that they stay the way they are. You see, when I came to Christ, I was believing things that weren't true. I didn't think that God had a purpose for me. I didn't think that there was a reason for my life, but God changed that. He spoke to me. He revealed Himself. People loved me and discipled me and helped me. Am I perfect today? No. But I am born again of the Spirit of God, and I have a desire to serve God. And I know that you, if not today, then when? You also can be one that can know Christ. And if you know Christ, you can be one who shares the truth. And if you share the truth, I encourage you to get behind ministries like ours, and let's take the gospel to places that you and I couldn't even dream of going, and partner with the body of Christ around the world as we share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thanks for watching today. I encourage you to watch next week. Might even be a little bolder than today, as we share the truth of God instead of believing the lies of the enemy.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today to make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477.